What's up guys, welcome to our channel. If you're new here, I'm Zoe, I'm a foundation dentist working here in London.
And I'm Ali, a final year dental student studying at Newcastle.
This video you're about to watch is a much shorter clip of the longer video we did on diagnosis. We just thought we'd put a shorter clip out there just in case anyone wanted to focus on this little topic. If you want to watch the full video, I'll put a link in the description.
So we're going to move on to the diagnosis of gum disease or periodontitis. You first need to take a periodontal screening for every patient that walks through your door. The screening tool used is called a basic periodontal examination, and if you're unsure of what that is, you can pause the video now and have a little look on your screen. Now that you've got a code for each sextant, the British Society of Periodontology have formed an in-depth sheet to follow, which we'll go through in this video. And keep in mind that this classification is also used internationally. A BPE score of 0 indicates healthy gums, while 1 and 2 would indicate some level of gingivitis, depending on how much bleeding you estimate to have seen.
So let's start by discussing a patient who scores 0s and 1s on their BPE. If while you were carrying out your BPE, you saw less than 10% bleeding when probing, this indicates clinical gingival health. If you saw between 10 and 30% bleeding on probing, you'll diagnose them with localized gingivitis. And finally, if there were more than 30% bleeding on probing, this would be a generalized gingivitis. Now, if they also scored a code 2 anywhere, you would supplement the gingival diagnosis with any plaque retentive factors or calculus which might have led to that score of 2. So for example, localized gingivitis due to overhanging restorations on upright 5, upright 6.
Let's start with code 3s only, no code 4s. You start by taking radiographs in the sextants with scores of 3 to assess if there's any bone loss in those areas. You will then do an initial periodontal therapy, which is just a combination of good supragingival scaling and oral hygiene instructions, and then wait 8 to 12 weeks for the inflammation to cool down. This will reduce any false pocketing, and if it was real pocketing, sometimes just good oral hygiene is enough to close the pocket. Once you have the patient back after 8 to 12 weeks, the guidelines say that you do a 6-point pocket chart in the involved sextants, but we think it's best if you just redo a BPE, and if they score a 3, then you carry out a 6-point pocket chart in the involved sextants. The 6-point pocket chart will record the pocket depths at 6 sites on each tooth, bleeding on probing, mobility, recession, and focations.
So that was for a BPE of a 3, but if the first time you saw the patient that had a BPE of 4, you skip the initial periodontal therapy and the 8 to 12 week wait, and you go straight into taking radiographs, doing a 4-mouth 6-point pocket chart, and forming your diagnosis. So now let's discuss forming your diagnosis. If they had scores of 3 initially, but after the initial therapy had no pockets deeper than 4 mm and no radiographic evidence of bone loss, you can diagnose them using the simpler diagnosis system of BPEs of 0, 1, and 2. If, however, you find that they have pockets deeper or equal to 4 mm, or have bone loss, or both, then you proceed to diagnose them using the code 4 pathway. And if your patient had BPE of 4 from the beginning, you also diagnose them with this pathway. In this pathway, if you notice that there's a pattern on just the molars and the incisors, this is diagnosed as periodontitis molar incisor pattern, followed by the staging, grading, stability, and risk factors, which we'll talk about in just a bit. If you find that there is less than 30% of teeth with pocket depths of less than or equal to 4 mm, and teeth with radiographic evidence of bone loss, this is diagnosed as localized periodontitis. More than 30% will be generalized periodontitis.
To classify the stage and grade, you need the radiograph that you took on that first appointment. Staging refers to the severity of the disease and is calculated using the worst site of bone loss, while grading refers to the rate at which the disease is progressing, and this is calculated using the percent of bone loss and the patient's age. You don't actually need to whip out a calculator on clinic, by the way. It's really simple maths. If the patient is 30 and you have more than 30% bone loss, then the ratio is more than 1 and that's grade C. And if it's that same 30-year-old who had a bone loss of 15%, that would be grade A, and if it's anything in between, then it would be grade B. Stability also needs to be assessed, and it would be tedious for me to just recite to you what you can already read, but it's important to note that anything which has a pocket depth of more than or equal to 5 mm will always be classified as unstable, which is something I've heard so many of my clinicians saying it's a flaw in the classification. Because if someone went from having 8 mm pockets down to 5 mm pockets, that's an amazing improvement, right? Even if it stays at 5 mm for the rest of their life, they will classify that as unstable. Risk factors include things like smoking and diabetes, but you can pause here for a full list taken from the BSP guidelines. Finally, combine everything you've found so far, and there you go, you've got your periodontal diagnosis.
One last diagnosis involving peri that we want to mention is a lateral periodontal abscess. This is similar to a periapical abscess, which we discussed before, but the difference is that it's on the side of the tooth instead of the apex, and the pulp is usually vital because pulp necrosis is not the cause here. A periodontal abscess is actually caused by the bacteria inside of a deep periodontal pocket. A pus-filled abscess may form when the immune system responds to the bacteria and attempts to isolate the infection from spreading. Usually, the pus will drain naturally through the pocket, but if there's something in there blocking the drainage, like calculus or trapped food, then the abscess can grow. Okay guys, so that was it for this clip. Thank you guys for watching. If you want to see the full video on diagnosis, I'll put in the suggestions here, or you can check out the other videos that we have on the channel.